done in a high-cost interest regime, the bank will get locked into a long-term high-cost debt. That's the flip side of it. And structured products, where are they existent in India? HDFC is the ideal case for structured products because they can bundle the securitized assets. Not happening. Automotives, bundling and securitization, not happening. Based on the American experience, we are talking of structured products. Structured products as a market is as yet nascent in India. In my view, they are not existent. And financial inclusion and the risk management system, given the fact that the financial system covers or tries to cover or intends to cover the individual, I believe the risk management that is talked about is on the KYC norms. Very often, the villager is unable to produce an address proof or an identity proof, or he does not have any sort of documents worth the name to open a bank account. He has no entry into institutions based on these norms. So the regulator, the governments have a larger role in developing something like a social security card or an ID card, which will do good for financial purposes, financial operation purposes, so that they get included faster into the system than insisting on these type of documents. Lastly, credit rating agencies. Now, the credit rating agencies do give the report at a particular point of time, therefore, which shifts from time to time. And the golden rule, as per the Sale of Goods Act, is caveat emptor. Now, if you're going to lend money, don't say that he recommended. I have seen Dun & Bradstreet reports where before opening an LC, we take a DNB report on the foreign supplier, and it says, more than 1 year history, not known. Said to be in the line of business indicated. Now, these are highly qualified remarks. These do not tell the banker anything. But so, putting the ball in the court of credit rating agencies will lead to practice of legal medicine. Now, legal medicine is putting you through unwanted tests so that he is absolutely safe. The doctor is absolutely safe that I have done all the tests. Now, this sort of a legal medicine, what could it be on the credit rating side? They will impose huge costs on the customer, and they will give a highly qualified report, which at the end of the day will not mean anything to you. Friends, let's understand one thing. Credit has got risks. Banking is acceptance of deposits for purposes of lending and or investment. In credit or foreign exchange, if somebody says that he wants to avoid risk, that's not the place for him. The old story about a foreign exchange dealer is that if a foreign exchange dealer says that he made profit in one out of four deals, he's a bad dealer. If he says that he made profits in two out of four deals, he's an average dealer. If he says three out of four, he's a good dealer. If he says four out of four, he's a liar. So, how can you control the markets? The markets don't know where they are headed, whether it is credit or forex or capital markets. There are inherent risks, and if we are not for those, if we cannot digest those type of risks, fixed deposits is our place. Now, lastly, reforms or regulations, pitting one against the other. Why not both? Now, this country's banking, I have seen over-regulated banking, deregulated banking, and regulate properly to somewhat, and we have also gone back to some regulations. For example, we had times when RBI will give out the periods, the maturity periods for which interest rate must be paid by all the banks. There is no distinction between A, B, C, D, or under the SSA sector, the lending rates. All those days are truly days of the past, truly gone. Now, reforms, hell a lot of scope. Not much has been done, not much has been attempted. Whatever was attempted in 1991 was, let's be very honest, was saying that we did earlier mistakes. The MRTP of 1969 was virtually thrown overboard. The draconian FERA of 1973 was virtually repealed in 1991. And private sector banking was put an end to in 1969, and banks were nationalized. By 1993, we were opening private sector banks. So in plain simple terms, it was an admission of the fact that our so-called socialist model had miserably failed, and that the reforms were not out of conviction, but out of compulsions. On this, I rest my case, and I believe that the system needs more reforms, and certainly the future is extremely bright. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Parth Sarathy. I think when you youngsters, when we talk about 1969, 1991, 1993, you do not understand all these things. Since we have experienced all these things, we remember all these rates of the dollar or interest rates or years and acts and draconian laws and all those things so very well. I think Mr. Parth Sarathy has really reeled out all those numbers because of his past experience. Thank you very much. But silently, as somewhere I pointed out, he has started firing. I'll add fuel to that. Let us see how Mr. Hirve will take it. With due regards to our regulator, he's from Reserve Bank of India. They've got a tremendous responsibility. Tremendous responsibility. Some of you banking students, if you have really gone through their history, they themselves were private bank for about 1938 to some 48, some 10, 15 years. I don't remember immediately the numbers, years, but about 35 to 48, 13 years they were a private bank. They themselves. And the whole story started after our independence, then planning, and then now I have a few more questions to add, whatever subtle way Mr. Partharji started questioning the regulators. See, when you've taken the SLR to 40% permissible, when you've taken the CRR to 15% permissible, in the process denying me 55% of the funds available to me to be lent profitably, do you expect me to be productive, profitable, transparent, etc., etc., was the banker's cry up to the reforms era 1993. So what he said was 1991-93, we tried to undo the earlier mistakes by scrapping the earlier laws and then reviving, and so many acts were revived. Negotiable Instrument Act has been changed, Securitization Act has been brought in, IT Act has been brought in, FERA has been changed to FEMA. If only a legal expert was here, possibly he would have also spent a long time. Legal reforms, taxation reforms, economic reforms, banking reforms, trade union reforms, 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 reforms. That means something was out of order before and now it has to be changed. We have to accept. China has started reforms in 1978 for agriculture purpose. A communist country, one party country, they can afford to do this. Whereas multi-party country, democratic country like us, we have been saying, what do you call this, NDAs and UPAs and collaborations and kind of parties and governments and changes and all that. Laws are not getting passed. Their hands are also tight. I have a few questions to add, whatever fire Mr. Parth Sarathy has started. Is Reserve Bank of India proactive or reactive or responsive? Is Reserve Bank of India adequately autonomous or are you only a government agent? Are you supervising or monitoring? Interest rates, you allow things to happen. Inflation, you allow things to take place and then realize, try to control and reduce it. How do you look at these things? Forex rates also, just like that, things keep happening. You intervene and how do you really bring it back to control? Money in circulation, we do not know how much black money, parallel money economy is absorbing and what's happening, how these things are really taking place. Otherwise, we go on talking third commission, fourth commission on reforms, reforms, reforms. And financial inclusion. I recently raised a debate in one of the conferences. Is it financial illusion? 60 years we have been talking about rural development, cooperative bank, commercial banks, regional rural banks, local area banks. All these banks have been created. Private money lender is still thriving. So is it a financial inclusion that we are aiming at or illusion? Another old wine in new bottle. Is it only just opening 250 accounts per branch per year or something else, taking the financial services down the line to the rural poor? Is just opening an account enough or are we creating economy, employment opportunities, income generation, savings, then opening accounts? Like this, is there dual supervision? There are RRBs, cooperatives, labs, local area banks and rural side of the commercial bank branches, you and NABARD both want to supervise, both want to regulate. What is this? Networking and IT, all the banking has been doing, whether networking is really going down the rural side so that the benefits will accrue. Similarly, SSI, SBF customers, when SIDBI has been created in 1991-92, nearly two decades have happened. Still, what is happening? Is there still dual, supervision, or really something exclusively professionally being done by that agency? SMERA has taken birth in 2005. How it is helping? Then non-banking financial companies have also passed through some kind of an order. Thanks to C.R. Bhansali, you must have seen in the last 1 week's Economic Times report, they have listed out all the scamsters, years, amounts, modus operandi. So NBFCs have also been going up and down. About 45,000 NBFCs were registered and are unregistered, financing, functioning in this country, in this economy. And after some act has been passed in 1998 or so, it has come down to less than 1,000. So data is only postmortem. Are we doing? Are we reactive or proactive? This is the kind of a concern I'm expressing. Even just now, he was mentioning about 1% on the DICGC. These are all decided very long time back. Are we dynamic or are we stagnant? And then even the thing like educational loans, up to 4 lakhs to the students without collateral security. Are you sure that this is being delivered to my scholarly students at engineering or medicine or professional? Still the bank manager is sending them back, asking for collateral. Are they not believing them? These kind of operational instructions are really going down the grassroots level and giving benefits to the genuinely needy people. Or similarly, just now a smart card he has mentioned about. India is providing IT services to the whole world. But within the country, we don't have a smart card. I have a passport, I have a voter card, I have a driving license, I have this, I have that, dozen cards I have. When is the social security system coming to place? One card, smart card, that can take us to any agency, any government department, any bank or any gas agency or so on and so forth, and also a bank account. When are we going to achieve this? When is IT revolution going to give the benefit? For that, what is the pressure on the government, pressure on the systems, the Reserve Bank as a professional body can give? Like this, sometimes the blame game goes. Some company like Satyam, whatever is happening, whether SEBI is faulty, whether FIPB is faulty, defective, or RBI could have taken steps in this, whose role is what? Whether the auditor is wrong, or Forex is going up, down, but Satyam we have not seen. So this monitoring or supervising is only a postmortem. Please throw some light, sir, with all the confidence that we are only taking the benefit of his presence, not trying to attack, or not trying to criticize or single out. He is among us. Possibly he will share his thoughts for our knowledge of the benefit of the students and all. Please.
Thank you very much. Initially, when I saw this, it's a big fight. I wanted to withdraw. Now I find that I'm in hopeless minority. And I don't know whether it is I'm isolated or I'm enjoying my majestic isolation. But well, I will summon the courage now and get the younger generation on my side. Will that do? Because my older colleagues here, my colleagues here, they have taken you to the foregone eras.
So 2 days back, they had a magic show. I don't think you are going to do some magic here.
So most of the things that they talked, probably none of them were born at that time. So it is so distant past for them, and they did tell you what we did, but they didn't tell you what they did. So we will not tell that. I will restrict myself to the topic whatever is mentioned here. The global financial crisis is the beginning, and we are now trying to review where our banking should be in light of that. So that analysis cannot be complete unless we know what really contributed to the global financial crisis. I'm sorry, I'm not going to get into that detailed analysis of whatever has happened. I will only tell you what Reserve Bank's analysis is, what were the factors which resulted, macro factors. I'm not going to the micro factors, failure of this institution or that institution, subprime crisis, it's all now recorded history. What really went wrong? What is the practitioner's view. I'm a central banker, and what is our view, central bank's view, as to what really went wrong? To us, it appears as the case wherein the risk was very horribly underpriced. Risk was not really properly priced. Underpricing of risk, failure of market, and also the inadequacies in the regulation and supervision. These three were the contributory factors, and there were some other global, economic factors. This is a banking factor, and these were the economic factors. There were the global imbalances were coming up, wherein, there was a huge current account deficit in US, and there was a surplus, huge current account surplus in developing countries like China, Korea, and so many other, and all that surplus was getting pumped into US. And as he has said, that was a lot of money, and they didn't know what to do with the money, and it came out with some sort of exotic products. And what was not a tradable thing, like housing, was traded. And there were so many other things which have happened, and probably it's now a history. I will not trouble you with all that. I will only confine to our analysis as to what are the issues here. One is, I said, as the global imbalance, how can we insulate ourselves from it so that this doesn't resurrect? Whether we can, if we have got a sufficient reserve, are we secure? Whether, what is the problem in regulation or supervision? Where, what should be done? How to improve the risk management? These are some of the issues which are more meta issues. I will not go into the smaller issues here. And I would say, what are the challenges for us, for the Reserve Bank, for the monetary authorities here? Let me tell you, we have comparatively quite a robust banking, and we have not been affected. The credit has not been given to us by anyone here. But it reminds me of the this thing in a Bhagavad Gita saying, which says that Yanisha Sarva Bhutanam Tasyam Jagarti Sayami. So things, when they were going wrong, we were very alert. And we had taken many, many measures proactively, so that what was happening, we had an inkling, or we had our own analysis as to what things are going wrong in the developed economies, and what can happen in future. And we were actually taking proactive measures like increasing the risk weights, putting controls on securitization, giving them right guidelines as to how securitization risk is to be managed. All those things were being done. It is not my intention to tell you about what we did, but the results are there before you. So now we have, the issue is not whether our banking system is in trouble or not. Issue really is, what are the implications of this global financial crisis on our economy, and how do we address that? The purpose of banking, it is not banking in itself. It's a social development. It's an economic development of the country that is more important. And whether we have this regulation or that regulation, it does not matter. Reforms or no reforms, we have to progress. So how do we, at this juncture today, what are our challenges? Now, our challenges for the central bankers in our monetary authority in India are, how do we ensure adequate liquidity for credit to grow? And how do we arrest the inflation and ensure price stability, at the same time ensure the growth? Now, it's a dilemma. We are facing this challenge, and that has to be reconciled. Then there are other issues of regulatory forbearance. When something really goes wrong, my banker's friend come running to us and say, oh, your regulation is useless. 90 days norms are not good. Risk weights are not good. That is hampering our progress. Your CRR is not good. Your SLR is not good. You give us some concessions. How do we grow? Let me tell you, in Reserve Bank, we are not interested in bankers. I mean, very sorry. We are interested in the depositors. Yes. Now I'm openly telling you. So our interest is for the depositors.
Crossfiring started.
Yes. It is the depositors' interest which is uppermost in our mind rather than a particular segment of the economy. Because it is they who give the banking the resources. And how do we ensure that the depositors' trust in the system is intact? That is our first and foremost consideration. So then it comes to the thing, what is the regulatory forbearance that we have to give? How much concession we have to give to the bankers? When they say, okay, this is not, as just now I was told, if supposing IRAC norms are introduced, the banking system will go for a toss. If 90 days norms, even today also bankers say that 90 days norms are not, which are something suitable. Securitization, we have killed a securitization market, that was a complaint last time. And today we have got some admirers definitely, but we don't know the bankers.